Hi, and welcome to the It's the People virtual roundtable series. My name is Joan Vorderbruggen, and I'm the director of Hennepin Theater District Engagement for Hennepin Theater Trust. With this series, we are bringing visibility to the themes that participating artists leveraged portrait photography for the public art project, It's the People. Today, we're going to talk with Nikki McComb, who is the executive director of Art is My Weapon, as well as city leadership and community leadership, to talk about gun violence prevention, which is a very important topic that our community faces. I hope you enjoy this segment and consider ways that you can support the community. Thank you. Welcome, everybody. Thank you for joining us today for this segment of the It's the People virtual roundtable. I'm really excited to have an incredible group of people here today to talk about a subject that is very relevant to the Hennepin Theater District and to our downtown and broader community. I'm welcoming participating artist Nikki McComb. Nikki McComb's public safety campaign titled #Enough uses art as a catalyst for change and social disruption. Taking on the unsolvable problem of illegal firearms, McComb uses photographs and video to reach people from the street level to the legislative arena and to help provide communities an outlet where they feel safe enough to seek help, empowered enough to give help, provoked enough to work harder to unify, and unified enough to make change collectively through art. In addition to being an art educator, she is the executive director of Art is My Weapon, an organization whereby local artists select decommissioned guns to then create new work for display. Welcome, Nikki, thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
We're also joined by Jamil Jackson, who is the executive director and CEO of Change Equals Opportunity. He's also a founding member of the Minnesota Freedom Fighters, a self-described elite security unit working to bridge the gap between police and the community. Thanks for joining us today.
Thank you.
Our next guest is Sasha Cotton, who has served as the city's youth violence prevention coordinator since 2014. And is the director of the Office of Violence Prevention for the City of Minneapolis. Her priorities include developing a strategic plan with measurable outcomes, accountability, and transparency. She has led the development of the new Minneapolis outreach team, who will be working to prevent widespread violence in the city. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
So Nikki, I wanna start with you as the participating artist and as someone who I've been collaborating with on this project for this past year. I know that you were really eager to participate because you leverage portrait photography in many different ways to speak towards a lot of issues that are near and dear to your heart. When I approached you about the possibility of being the artist who would bring forward the theme of violence prevention, I'd suggested a couple of individuals to maybe work with. And one of the things that struck me about collaborating with you was that you had a really clear vision about the people that you wanted to bring forward to be a part of this portrait and this work you were going to create. And it was a different approach really than any of the other artists in this project really took. And so I just wanted to ask you a little bit about the process and how you made the decision to include the people that you included in your portrait.
Decisions usually take time, but it didn't take time because the question was very simple. And the answer is as simple as the question, and that is giving people who are oftentimes overlooked or seemed controversial or whatever the case is, the ability and opportunity to participate in something, to actually gain and reap reward for the work that they're doing. And that was really just it. Mm-hmm. So that's why I chose. I mean, some of the folks at that time had actually not received proper accolades, I should say. They may have received attention or encouragement or whatever the case is. But I think that there's a proper route to giving people access to information and accolades that they deserve, and that's just, I just felt that it was important to be able to do that.
Mm-hmm. I really appreciated learning so much more about different community outreach efforts and leaders that I maybe hadn't worked with before, who do intersect with the work that's happening in the Hennepin Theater District too. And that representation with a public art project like this being available. So I really appreciated you bringing those folks to the project. I'd love to know a little bit more and share with the audience a little bit more about the Art is My Weapon initiative that you lead and that and some of the work that's been done and coming up.
Okay, so Art is My Weapon actually came about when I was working at Pillsbury United Communities. And under the leadership of Shonda Smith Baker, I managed what she founded as Art is My Weapon to follow the work in New Orleans that Jonathan Ferrara had done in Guns in the Hands of Artists. So we brought Jonathan here and did a very large exhibition of the work that he had done with artists. And a few years prior, Shonda's cousin was murdered. And so when she saw the exhibit and saw how we were able to make some impact, she wanted to start her own under the organization. And so I want to do it. So I was the person in line to do the work and lead the work. And so I did that. And then Shonda moved on in her career. And shortly after that, I moved on in my career, but I was able to take that with me because the agency was not going to continue to produce exhibits or work. So the ownership became mine. Mm-hmm. And so the organization literally tries to get weapons off the street through gun buybacks and through donations of guns from collectors and such, decommissioned, to give to artists so that they create different types of art in their medium, whether it's sculpture, photography, painting, mosaic works, metal works, whatever the case is. I've got some artists that built kitchen tables out of weapons. So it's taking something dangerous and damaging and creating something beautiful and useful.
Mm-hmm. And I know that you recently did a garden, a community garden that had the benches from, so there was a collaboration, placemaking effort. Do you mm-hmm. want to tell us a little bit about that project?
So it was a two-part thing, because the year prior I actually built the benches with young people and families. And then this year was looking for a home for them where community can actually come to them and utilize them as a private space and place to honor people they lost to gun violence. So they're similar to like the locks of love in France. These are actually locks of honor. The benches were constructed through metalworks and blacksmithing to create places for locks to be hung with names that can stay forever. So there's five benches. Three of the benches are able to be house locks. One bench is dedicated solely to Burdell Beeks, who was murdered on Penn Avenue. I worked very closely with her daughter on all sorts of things, but primarily her family and young people from the community in actually creating and building the bench out of some of the decommissioned gun parts. And so there's two benches at North Market and three benches at Oak Park Center in the very back where we've got a fence that can also be used as a place for locks to get hung with names. So really just places and spaces for people to go and honor their loved ones.
Mm-hmm. That's awesome work. I think about the opportunity for the new Hennepin that we face with the construction, and I'm just curious about just throwing that out there, that might be a really interesting way to approach furniture mm-hmm. on Hennepin. So thank you for doing and leading that work. Jamil, I was wondering if you could just tell us a little bit about your organization and the mission behind that, and just anything you want to share about the work that you're doing in community.
Yeah, so as you stated in the bio, the Minnesota Freedom Fighters were created after the the death of George Floyd. So when we saw what was happening in South Minneapolis in terms of buildings being burnt and rioting, we decided that, well, the community was, there was a call from the community, from the president of the NAACP, to ask for members of the community to step up to help make sure that our buildings didn't burn and our community didn't end up looking like that. So out of everyone who showed up, there was a band of brothers, is what we call ourselves, right, who continued to show up after we decided that enough was enough in terms of the protection. And what I started to realize with these guys is that within this time spent, they started to realize their purpose and their responsibility to the community through the work that we did and the comments from community in terms of support and respect and appreciation. And so we took it upon ourselves to say that this has to be more than just for this moment, right? This is actually something that we should have been doing a long time ago, but God works in mysterious ways, right? And hence, here we are as the Minnesota Freedom Fighters. Our role today is to bridge the gap between community and police, to help play an accountability role, if you will, for both and, making sure that the police are doing what they're paid to do within our communities and making sure our community is holding themselves accountable to their actions as well.
Mm-hmm. I know that Nikki had referred to you as Coach. Yeah. And that's your nickname. Yeah. In the community.
Yeah.
And hearing this, hearing you talk about how bringing people together around this crisis that the community was facing provided some purpose, it sounds to me as if you have a penchant for building leaders and leadership in the community.
Yeah, I guess I would. I mean, I don't see myself as that, right? I just see myself walking my day-to-day walk as who God made me. But, I mean, yeah, it lends itself to being a builder of leaders, if you will.
Mm-hmm. That's great. And then the you're the CEO of the Changes.
Change Equals Opportunity.
Yeah. Do you want to tell us a little
bit
about
that? So Change
Equals
Opportunity is a life skills mentoring program aimed at males of color ages 12 to 25 in the areas of education, employment, and life skills. And so with building relationships with communities, schools, parks, we come in and we do youth groups. Our purpose is engagement, relationships, and trying to help with resources. So exposing youth to career opportunities, internships, job shadowing, college tours. We run a basketball league. And we kind of use these things as carrots to bring the kids in and build authentic relationships to where we can then be that go-to when they're in times of need, whether it's stress-related, tension, mediator, mentor, whatever it needs to be. I also own and operate a few businesses under the CEO umbrella where we focus on hiring youth and felons. So give them the opportunity to see work from a different perspective, from an entrepreneurial perspective, and see if this is the route that they want to take, because obviously the routes that they were going aren't working for them, right? So just another layer of exposure.
Mm-hmm. That's awesome. I'd love to find out more too about those businesses and how we can support. So yeah, we might want to touch on that later in the conversation.
Let's do it.
Thank you. Sasha, thanks so much for joining us. So you took on a role, was it a little more than a year ago?
Yep, I've just lapsed my 1 year back in July, so just over a year.
Happy anniversary, and thank you for the work that you've been leading this past year. So tell us a little bit more about the Office of Violence Prevention and the work that you all are leading today.
Yeah, so the Minneapolis Office of Violence Prevention is a part of the Minneapolis Health Department. We focus on public safety through a public health lens and really trying to balance the approach of bringing community to the table to address public safety in partnership sometimes with law enforcement, but really community-driven strategies that don't always require a law enforcement lens.
Mm-hmm. And you recently launched a new initiative, I mean really recently.
Yeah, within the last few weeks, early August, the city of Minneapolis invested in a new initiative that is modeled after Cure Violence, which is a project that's been done internationally to address violence as a public health issue through what they call interrupters. It's really well-trained outreach workers and teams that are strategically placed in communities with high rates of gun violence. And the role is not, again, much like the Freedom Fighters, not to replace police, but to really do predictive analysis on where the next shooting might happen, to be constantly interrupting the cycle of retaliatory violence. We know so much of the gun violence in our city is really a cycle of back and forth engagement between groups, gangs, cliques, whatever you'd like to call them. And so this work is really strategically focused on that. And so we've got teams of roughly 20 individuals in four unique parts of the city that have been deeply hit by gun violence, as well as trying to help provide some support in our downtown corridors as requested. And so we're really excited about the project. It is new and complements some of our existing work, like our group violence intervention and our hospital-based work called Next Step.
Mm-hmm. And the Office of Violence Prevention partners with lots of different community partners that work in many different ways. I know even Hennepin Theater Trust and the 5 to 10 on Hennepin had some support in the past from that office, which was really, I mean, really made the difference between kids being able to get up on a stage and sing their life and have positive activities that really centered them. I think we talk about opportunities and centering individuals in spaces where they maybe, you know, from what we heard from feedback from that program was oftentimes don't necessarily feel safe and are looking for a place to belong. So I really appreciate the placemaking priorities that you have led to with the initiatives that you've worked on, and just how important it is to have space and to have safe adults and you know, individuals and things to aspire to and feel as if this is your place.
Right.
But to your point, Sasha, about the interrupters, I think that's a really interesting way to approach violence prevention. Some of the feedback that I've heard, especially with violence that's happening in downtown as such a centralized location where a lot of people go, is that a lot of violence and stuff that sort of starts online and it starts in these other areas and then manifests in particular areas, which obviously you and your team has identified. Do you want to talk about how some of that plays out and how your initiative is maybe addressing that?
Yeah, I mean, the online piece is such an important place to be looking, and we've learned a lot about that through our group violence intervention work and in our partnership with HCMC and now North Memorial with our Next Step program. I think so many folks think that when we're talking about group dynamic and retaliatory violence, that we're thinking about the organized gangs and groups of the late 80s and early 90s, and that there's a hierarchy and, you know, gang territory. And what we know is that most of it is deeply interpersonal, and that, yes, people are attached to groups or names of groups or titles because it makes them feel a part of something. It helps them to create in a negative way the things that Coach and Nikki's work really allow kids to participate in a positive way, that they're a part of something, they're connected to an identity, whether that be something like CEO or Art as My Weapon. When kids don't have that, they'll find it in other places. And it's not always highly organized, and a lot of the conflicts arise online. And so having adults who are intentionally looking at the online presence, talking with young people about those conflicts. I mean, what starts as a, you know, you dated my girlfriend or you disrespected my friend who was killed, escalates really quickly. And with the rapid rate at which we know illegal guns are available in our community, gunplay can be a secondary outcome rapidly. And so intervening before it happens, particularly with retaliation, is really, really important to minimizing the violence we're seeing in our city.
Mm-hmm. And can you tell us more about the Next Step program, what that's about?
Sure. Next Step is a hospital-based intervention program, which is a national best practice. It is really thought nationally by violence prevention experts that having something like our new Minneapolis interrupter model, the hospital work at HCMC and now North Memorial, and hopefully expanding to some other hospitals soon, as well as our group violence intervention strategy, are really critical large-scale infrastructures you want to build out, sustain, and have really well-staffed if you're going to have violence prevention strategies that work. Mm-hmm. And so at our hospitals, we have frontline violence interruption staff who are meeting at the bedside with an individual who comes in with a serious injury, whether that be a shooting, which most often is what we're seeing, but also stab wounds or other serious injuries caused by violence are met with a bedside intervention, because we know that so often with modern medicine, people come in and they're stitched up and sent home really rapidly. Mm-hmm. And that's not addressing all of the trauma that someone has experienced being a victim. And it's also not looking at the long-term root causes that made that person vulnerable. And so in addition to that bedside intervention and that relationship development, we're looking at, does an individual have a safe place to return to? Do they have needs around employment? Do they have needs around mental health? And really trying to provide full wraparound services, both that are relational and meeting the basic needs that a person has to take the next steps towards safety. And also, again, all of our work really focuses on that retaliation. So trying to ensure that that person realizes that retaliating for what happened to them is not a pathway forward that's going to help them be successful, and giving them things to do in replacement with that energy is really critical.
Wow, that's really important work. Nikki, I know you have a lot of experience too in your career working with victims of violence. Do you want to talk a little bit about some of that backstory and also how you, I've seen you intersect with victims of violence and creating artwork and just a lot of wrapping people with support.
Yeah. So I actually worked in the Next Step program too. I was a former staff member, and so a lot of the, even prior to that, with my Enough campaign and the photo projects, a lot of those folks who still are victims of gun violence with unsolved crimes that they still have not received justice for, I still communicate with them quite often, actually. And I always share their stories and connect them to other people that can help with the coping and people that have been there or people that are experienced in trauma and so on and so forth. I mean, there's not a whole lot of financial things I can do until I go after something to try to do more. But being able to connect people to each other in order to serve a purpose in coping in trauma, especially in gun violence, is one thing on its own. So I've seen a lot. I have not been affected by gun violence personally, but I felt like I have all these other skills, and so I'm gonna have to use them some way. So I was just like, oh, I can do this and I can do that. And so that's just what I do. I just am one of those people that want to make people feel like they have a way to get over, through and around whatever it is that is ailing them. And it just happens to be that I was profoundly affected by gun violence and how it affects people.
Mm-hmm. You've driven a lot of really amazing work that's really inspiring. So I really invite people who may be watching this segment to check out those initiatives and exhibits that are forthcoming, which we can talk a little bit more about too. Jamil, what else would you like to share about the work that you're leading? What types of opportunity are you seeing with how you intersect with the community, and that how we spoke about that bridge that needs to be built between the police and the community?
Yeah, so I mean, I think that what we're doing is we're showing a whole new perspective of men of color with guns, right? Usually in our community, when you see a black man with a weapon, he's usually viewed as a criminal, either going or coming from, right? And so being able to stand with our community and show them that we're, again, here holding the police accountable, but then also in facing at our community, and not just holding them accountable, but also having conversations about what that accountability looks like, right? How it's our responsibility to play a role in this and not just be a bystander until something happens to us personally. And biggest for me, I guess, is again, with the work that I do within CEO, now having a committed group of men to dedicate, right, to kind of spread our wings more into the community to grasp these young males, especially in a time like now where COVID is happening and there's no school, there's no gyms, there's no parks, right? They're getting very creative of how they're entertaining themselves.
You bring up a really good point. Would any of you like to talk about just how the pandemic has been affecting the work that you're leading and sort of the ways that you're seeing it play out in the community?
Well, for me and my organization, not that much of an impact in terms of engaging the youth, because they're still out there, and we're still doing some creative stuff within ourselves to make it happen. So we've partnered with the park board in terms of getting the league running with COVID restrictions, so giving them something to do on the weekends, still taking youth to job sites. So I own a construction business, a lawn care business, and a automotive business. We buy and sell cars. And so those things are still in motion, if you will. So we still have the opportunity to reach kids and teach kids and give them an opportunity. So it's affecting us as it relates to school, but not in terms of the community.
Mm-hmm. I would certainly jump in and say that from the city's perspective, and as I mentioned before, the Office of Violence Prevention is housed in the Public Health Department. And so the intersection of public health and public safety has really been brought to the forefront. I've been calling it the perfect storm. With the onset of COVID and the crisis, particularly in Black and Brown communities, the increasingly high rates that Black and Brown communities have experienced the COVID pandemic, paired with the murder of George Floyd, paired with the unrest that followed, communities have been hit very hard. And we know that summer months tend to bring about increased violence, but what we've seen this summer has been exponentially high. And our ability to do the things that we would normally do, like gather, like bring people together, like saturate with community resources, I won't say aren't possible, but they're a lot harder, simply because we have to, at the city level, operate with a great degree of carefulness around COVID exposure. We can't afford to have, our work is so important, and I'm not saying that as it relates to me personally, but we partner with the work that Nikki does, we partner with the work that Jamil does, and so many other organizations. And so for us, even to come together like this, the potential that all three of us could share COVID in this experience could be detrimental to community. And so our self-preservation, and not having 20 organizations that do violence prevention work sitting at a table together, it's really hard, but it's really necessary to make sure that there's someone there to do the work on behalf of our children. And so we have been hit with high need, but also hit with high risk. And so mitigating that has been a big part of my work this summer.
Mm-hmm. And serving as that convener that the city, it's really hard to convene people right now.
We see ourselves as a convener and as a incubator, as a engine for the work that's happening on the ground. The city certainly can't do it all, but our goal is to partner with those who are doing and to help support, whether that be through the limited resources that we have financially, but also through technical assistance and systems navigation and helping people identify the right place to be at the right time. And all of that gets bogged down when you're trying to protect people from catching an awful disease that has plagued our country, but particularly the communities of color here and across the country.
Mm-hmm. And is it true that in addition to all of those challenges and increased risk and impact, that domestic violence has also increased during this time for community?
Yeah, that's true too. In addition to the community violence that we've seen, so our shootings are triple what they would normally be. A lot of those increased shootings are domestic related, whether they be what we would call intimate partner violence, so a romantic relationship, or family violence, which is, anyone who is related through a kinship network, right? We know that a lot of our young people are used to getting what we call a respite from chaos when they're going to school or going to programming or going to work, and a lot of those things aren't available anymore. So they're on top of each other and on top of family and houses that may be trauma invoking. We know that people don't have the financial resources that they used to have because people aren't working. And so that additional stress is not causal, but it certainly has impact on the circumstances around stress and over drinking and over consuming and addiction and mental health that all get exacerbated by a pandemic. And so we're seeing excess of everything right now with real limitations on our ability to address it the way that we normally would.
So I would love, with the suggestion that we got from Sasha, for you all to consider talking about each other and what you admire about the work that each of you are doing in the community. So Sasha, this was your great idea.
That means I get to go first.
Kick us off.
Yeah. Okay. So I'll tell like my origin story with Coach. When I first started as the Youth Violence Prevention Coordinator with the city, you know, I was coming from the university, but also had really, at the university, it's a national institute, so I've been working not as much in Minneapolis, but really around the country on violence prevention, particularly with the issue of domestic violence in Black and Afro-Latino communities. And so I was regrounding myself in the Twin Cities and finding who the players were, and heard about the great work he was doing and said, like, I gotta talk to this guy. He was like, nah, I don't want to talk to you.
Okay.
You know.
This is truth.
It's super true.
And we know that it's the truth.
I don't want to talk to the city. You guys are totally not invested in what I'm trying to do. I'm about building communities and building young people. And you guys say you care about that, but you don't, right? And I was like, but I'm not defeated that quickly. And so I showed up at his gym. I made my kid play in his league. You know, I just like inserted myself in his way to the point where I was like, yeah, you gotta work with me, right? Like, you're doing amazing stuff here and reaching kids in the way that this office is gonna be about, or this work is gonna be about under my leadership. And so he has been an amazing partner to the work that we are doing in the Office of Violence Prevention. The energy in his gym, and it's not just about basketball, it's about leadership. Is palpable, and to see him with young people and adults is really inspiring. And so I think anytime you can leverage something like basketball, which sounds so commercial, right? They're like, oh, let's get a bunch of kids in the gym and they can play basketball and they'll love it. It sounds mediocre at best, but what he's doing is recreating lives through basketball. And really the way he says it is using it as a carrot to get young people to the table so that they can transform lives. And I really have seen that happen through his work with his own organization, through his work in partnership with our office as a consultant. And so I'm bragging a bit, but super honored to work with him on a daily basis. Then to my girl, Nikki. Nikki and I have had a unique partnership for a long time. And I don't talk about it often, but as an artist myself, so I'm not a physical artist, but I've been in the theater for a long, long time, really see the inspiration that she brings in a living, breathing way to young people around art, which is such an underutilized thing in Black and Brown communities. It's such a deep-seated part of our culture, but it's a practice, unlike sports, that we get kind of made fun of wanting to be a part, or we get shunned for wanting to do it. And so I think, you know, weapons, for better or for worse, have been glamorized in our society as a whole, and certainly in the vein of Black and Brown communities and the way we see ourselves portrayed in the media. And so being able to motivate young people through the decommissioning of weapons to do art is just so creative and inspirational, and she brings her own twist to it. The bench project that she did, I mean, I have an ask of her about it later. But it's a, not only is it innovative, but it's also something that has a legacy component, right? Because mm-hmm. those benches aren't going anywhere. And so the ability to provide that kind of space, I think, is cathartic. I know that one of the young people that worked on the project has a long-term job now working in welding at an art mm-hmm. institute in the cities.
Wow.
And so the impact that both of them are making on lives that I can point to and say, but not for this person, this kid might not be here, or this kid wouldn't be where they are, or might not be on the planet, is really, really important. And I think prevention's always hard to measure, and it's hard to recognize because it's hard to count what you can't see. But I see it, and I see you. And so I'm just always honored and proud to be at tables with them.
Just so.
Aww.
That's awesome. It's nice, and it's a great perspective to describe it from your lens as someone who is in a leadership position at the city, to have metrics that you can show, to be able to work with really creative leaders and people who maybe would never intersect with the city. To your point of your story that you're like, I'm not going there.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure I forced myself upon the city myself as well. Like, I didn't do what you did, but I was like, excuse me, can you see me? Because I'm right here.
Yeah, like the opposite. He's like, right. I want nothing to do with it. And she's like, hello, arts, young people, health, like, this is our thing. What is wrong with you guys?
Get with the program.
Right, yeah, so my that's my story with her is I was, hello, we're going to do something. And I just kept, you know, and it wasn't just Sasha, but it was, you know, our when you deal with people for so long on certain stuff, the same stuff, you know, you develop the professional friendship, right. But you develop a friendship. And right. So you cross over into other territories where, you know, you really can say, like, that person believes in the work that I'm doing. And that's, I think, how I feel about both of them. I ain't gonna tell your story. I ain't gonna tell it.
That's all right.
He's the dude I call when I know I got a kid that's like just.
Right.
And I'm like, I got a kid. Can he work? Can he do this?
It's not an ask. It's I got a kid.
Right.
Calling.
Right. Or I'm like trying to politic on how I can get the kid to call him without it making it look like I just did this with him, like without it making it look like a setup or, you
know, right.
Whatever. So, because there's very few people that are in community that are males that you can send a male kid to, that they're gonna accept what they're saying or feel comfortable or, you know, and he's just one of those guys. Mm-hmm.
And has multiple pathways to opportunity, mm-hmm. which is critical.
Yeah, man. So, I mean, similar. So, me and Nikki definitely have a past. No, but what I appreciate about Nikki and her work is that, again, as Sasha said, it's unique, right? We don't put a lot of emphasis on art. And one of the reasons why I use basketball as a carrot is my own son is an artist. And I didn't know he was an artist until his sophomore year in high school. And how we found out was he kept a sketchbook underneath his mattress. We never had an idea. My son is 6'6", 40-inch vertical, and our head, Division I basketball player, right? Potential NBA. Mm-hmm. Now, always kept school in the forefront, but this was, you know, our talk. This was the community's talk. Everywhere we went, this was the expectation for him. But what we didn't know is that he didn't want it, right? That art was his thing. And so when we found this sketchbook, you know, we sat him down and had a conversation, and he was kind of just nonchalant with it. But it brings back, you know, lends to the conversation of how we don't give it, you know, its proper recognition that we need, and so many kids are lost because we don't do that. So I have so much respect for Nikki, not just in the work but in her as a person, because she speaks her truth. And that's honorable, right? I mean, a lot of people sugarcoat or won't give you in the raw or feel like they're hurting your feelings or something, and that's not Nikki at all, right? And I appreciate that, and I value that, right? And I expect her to hold me accountable to my rights because we're a community. Again, what Sasha said is true. When I actually applied for the job that she had. And in my head, I was it, right? I was the one for that position. I should have got that position. So I remember she had an introduction at a Hawthorne huddle. And so I showed up, I was in the back, and then I came up and introduced myself. But she was right. I was dead set against it. I didn't believe at the time the city was serious about making real change. They just wanted the illusion of change. And here I was, somebody who had built my organization from grassroots to, you know, something bigger, and was self-performing, if you will. I didn't feel like I wanted it or needed it. But as she was very persistent, and through that persistency and me listening to her talk and seeing her interact and realizing, okay, she's not the norm. She's very different. The way that she can calm a tense room, right? The verbiage that she, I mean, I tell her all the time, like, you're dope, Like, for real, I could not have done this. God chose the right person, mm-hmm. right, for this position. Mm-hmm. And now, I mean, like, inseparable. Like, I can't see myself leaving this work with her still being in it. I'm that loyal to her because she's been that loyal to me.
Same.
Right. Mm-hmm. And I mean, it transcends professionalism, our relationships.
It's a powerful quality. I too have witnessed Sasha right. speak in a very tense room and in a way that is mm-hmm. just tremendous. Yeah. And I didn't know that you had a theater background, and so you have this background and presence, and because you and I have been in rooms together that have been, you can hear a pin drop, and it's just like, how is this gonna go? So.
Yeah, I mean, I agree. We all have gifts, and I'm not nearly as talented as an artist. I'm not nearly the leader that Jamil is of men in particular. And so I feel like what the city can offer, and particularly our office can offer, is the facilitation of those skills, right? Like, the city so often feels like a place that's not really for the people, and I've tried to make the Office of Violence Prevention be something different. And so I'm super humbled by your comments, but it's just not possible without all of us. I will give a little like blurb that's not public yet completely, but the Office of Violence Prevention's new logo will launch soon, and the title is, you know, Minneapolis Us. It takes all of us to prevent violence. Mm-hmm. And that is really a sincere belief of mine, that like, whether it's the neighbor or the dad or the teacher or the aunt, we all have a role in keeping our community safe. And when we lay that responsibility at the feet of government and law enforcement, we cut ourselves mm-hmm. short, and we cut mm-hmm. our community short. Mm-hmm. And so there's a way for all of us to step up. And these two individuals have been doing that for years. And our work now is to cultivate the next generation of people who are going to fill our shoes.
It's a beautiful segue to the next area that I wanted to ask you all is, you know, Hennepin Theater Trust really intends to, for this particular segment to be seen by a broad audience. But we also do have a particular audience, many of whom are people who buy tickets to see shows in our theaters. And we hope that they'll tune in too. With that being said, I guess I'm curious to know, what are some ways that the community can support your work or support the work of prevention? And Sasha, I love the way that you frame that. It's all of us. It's we're all accountable for our young people, and we're all accountable for our community and the needs that they have in preventing violence from happening. But being that this group of people here have worked for decades and have made it a life's passion to work in this space, what are some ways that people can support?
So I'll start.
Good.
And I say this as kindly and nicely as I can, but it's, and you know this, it's rough to be a one-man band, right? And I'm a one-man band. And that's just simply because I can't afford it to do anything else. You know, I can afford it when I go after a grant or a, you know, a fellowship or whatever else to execute a one-off thing that could, like you said, you know, this last thing will endure for some years. But, you know, I have to, before I even finish that, figure out how I'm going to plan in order to sustain the next thing or plan the next thing to get more dollars to possibly save two more kids, three more, you know what I mean? Because the kid that she spoke of earlier, that now is a full-time employee at Chicago Fire Arts, was literally sleeping in his car when I brought him into help with the benches. And he was the main participant. Like, he showed up every day. He took four different buses to get there. There were times where we just stayed late because he was so late from taking the buses that we just stayed late, and I would make sure he ate and had somewhere to go or had food or whatever the case was. And I lost contact with him, and Heather from Chicago Fire Arts called me and was like, showed up here and was like, I need a job. And she just happened to have a huge project that she knew he could handle, because he literally learned every single way to manipulate and use the tools in that place, and it's scary.
Wow.
Like, it's a scary place.
Yes, it is.
The Fire Arts Center?
Yeah. Because it's very dangerous work.
It's blacksmithing and, like,
welding.
Yeah.
Right. And so, but he learned it all. And so now he's working there. And to me, that's a win. He was also affected by gun violence. So it's just an all-around win. And when you can connect, when someone like me can connect with someone like Sasha and someone like Coach and someone like Heather, and someone like this, and someone like that, to save lives, it takes money. Mm-hmm. And I don't have it. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm going and, here, let me get this couple dollars, and let me get this couple dollars. I need capital. I need some real people who really care to help, so that I can do more for the city. I can do more for you. You can do more for me with more money. Like, it's a whole thing. It's a whole big thing. You know this.
I do. And I do really appreciate that from the artist perspective too, and the work and the impact that your particular practice has mm-hmm. on young people and on people in the community. I mean, we hear all the time the arts community has been hit so hard mm-hmm. by the pandemic. So many jobs have been lost and just opportunities have shifted. But the thing that you hear consistently is just that the hustle takes so much capacity. And not having staff, not having, you know, not being able to do forecasting and future planning, because the second year even into a project, you've got to be thinking about all that stuff. Mm-hmm. So I really appreciate that, and I'm excited to share information about how you can be supported in this work. And I ask the same question of you, Jamil. What are some of the ways that the community can? And I know that contributions are,
right,
are probably
right.
going to
so
be
I'm,
the top
I'm
of the list.
With that.
That's,
echo
that's
that,
all good.
Right?
Yeah,
funding
that's all good.
Is the biggest piece, but for me, it's actually broader. I need engagement. I need access to opportunities. Right. So from job shadowing to internships to guest speakers to expose to different opportunities, right? A lot of these kids don't even know half of these careers that exist, right? We just talked last Sunday about how the mascot in the NBA starts out at $63,000 a year. Go figure, right? Right.
Yeah, that is a shocking
right.
fact.
So,
it's a really right. obscure so, one, but wow.
Well, and so my thing, even with basketball, again, back to the care piece, is that we bring the kids in with sports, but we use it to expose them to all these other opportunities. I mean, there are so many six-figure careers that exist within the sports realm that have nothing to do with actually being on the field or on the court, right? Which still keeps you close to the love of your game, engaged, right? But our kids aren't being exposed to that, because once they become invaluable to a coach, then there's no more growth in that realm anymore. And so we need ex-college players, right? People who have played, even professional, to come back and share their stories with these young men and women, so they can understand that there are more opportunity exists above and beyond. And right, financial literacy. I mean, it just goes on and on. Ultimately, it's just about exposure, right? And the thing for me at that age was exposure. The more you're exposed to, the more possibilities you can see for yourself. Right? So relationships, exposure, financing.
Mm-hmm. That's wonderful. And what are some of the businesses that are happening in the community right now that have that model of that apprenticeship and that job path you said that you are
So doing? Like for me, interior remodeling. So the construction trades are huge. That's an easy way to allow youth and people to come in and learn some skills. And not just skills with their hand, but soft skills, right? How to engage people, how to build client relationships, how to manage your books, all those type of things. Cars, I mean, there's so many hands-on things that are still moving. Again, our kids love to be active, and if we're exposing these things to our kids, then they would detailing cars, painting cars, mechanics, engineering, plumbing,
Videography,
yeah. right?
Photography.
Which we actually do at our league. So I hire 15 youth every summer to do videography of the league. And then we go back and they create highlight films for kids that are trying to go to school. We do a broadcast where I have some kids sit at the table and try to mimic broadcasting so they can learn that aspect of the game. Still photography. Again, it's just exposure.
Yep, that's wonderful. Yeah. And it'll be great to share with this audience some of the ways that they can reach you and the work that you're doing. Sasha, you're leading a lot for the city and doing a tremendous job. What are some ways that the community can support the work that you're doing within the Office of Violence Prevention?
Yes, I mean, obviously our ask, our thoughts are different. A lot of it is about supporting the work of these folks and folks like them. The city is a conglomerate, right? And there's money there. It's all about them moving it around and redistributing resources to the things that matter. And so, you know, we're never gonna get into a dialogue about defund the police versus keep the police, right? That's not our role in public health. We work with every tool in the toolbox to keep our community safe. But what is important is to have the valuable resources to fund this work and other work like it, and to support it and make it better, right? Like, they need training, they need accountants, they need all the supports that they talked about. And if public safety is one of the number one priorities of local government, here it is, folks, right? Like, it's not just uniforms, and it's not just fire trucks, and it's not just streets. It's people power. It's organizations that keep our young people engaged so that they never interface with the violence, right? In a perfect world, that's what we have. And in lots of other places, you know, my mantra here lately has been suburbanize the hood, right? Like, not in the sense of taking away our flavor and our swagger, but suburban municipalities have what they need, generally speaking. And the deficits we experience in our urban communities is really about resource. And so apply pressure to your council members to put the resources in the things that you care about. And if you care about this, then ask them to fund it.
Excellent. And you can see, Sasha, you can see you and you, Coach, and others. The Nikki's photograph is up on street pole banners along Hennepin, on digital billboards that are going to expand across the city and across some other cities also, too, and static billboard that was just put up. So more to come about that, but you can check out it's the People Public Art Project along Hennepin Avenue. And I just want to thank everybody for joining us today for this online virtual roundtable to be able to find out more about the incredible and impactful work that all of you are doing for us. Very grateful to you today.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for joining us for this segment of the It's the People virtual roundtable. I hope that you learned a lot and that you will seek out ways to continue to support our community. Please join us for our next segment, which will center trans equity, and specifically trans equity issues for service members. We hope to see you then. Thank you.